6:46 this Saturday morning, and New Orleans Police Superintendent Ronald Surpass has been on the job for a matter of days now, and he's already fully immersed in what promises to be a challenging role as the new chief of New Orleans Police. Superintendent Surpass sat down with WDSU news anchor Randy Russo to talk about these very busy first couple of weeks. She's on your side with our one-on-one interview.
Well, Superintendent Surpass, it's been nearly 2 weeks that you've been on the job. You've invited the public to ComStat meetings. You've also been actively involved with the Department of Justice and also getting folks to maybe write into the new email account system that you all have created. Is it fair to say that you're really wanting to get the public involved and that you're really wanting to gain public trust?
Absolutely. Crime fighting is never successful without the full and complete support of the public, because they see everything that we don't see. They know the things that we don't know. We want to encourage the public, report the crime to us. We want more crime reports. We want more crime information. We don't want less. To get less would be that we'd be wrong, and we don't want that. And so far, things are going very well. We've already had one narcotics arrest come off of the NOPD chief at cityofneworleans.com. We're very excited about that. We put that out. We made sure the community knew it. We're also about to start a citizens callback program. In the next few days, what we're going to do is randomly call back victims of crime. And we're going to ask them the first most important question. Here is the crime report in front of me. I'm going to read it to you. Is this what happened? And get that first confirmation from the lowest possible level in the process that what the citizen said happened is what we have recorded. Then there'll be a series of questions about the officer's professionalism, the officer's performance of duty. Did you get assistance from other parts of the NOPD that you should have gotten? And we're going to do that. In Nashville, in 5 years, we called back 4,000 people. And 99.7% of the time, those 4,000 people said, well, what you just read to me is what I told the police. It's a confirmational process. It's the starting of an auditing process. And most importantly, it's touching citizens who have been victimized one more time and just saying, you know, we're still thinking about you. We're still interested in what happened to you.
Well, do you think those folks that you're speaking of, are they weary right now of the New Orleans Police Department?
I think there's no question that there's some corners of the city of New Orleans that have lost faith and confidence in the police department. And that's our biggest challenge, is to rekindle that, because usually, and not uncommonly, in those areas where the loss of confidence is at its height is where usually crime begins to take a foothold and people are being victimized. And it's that cooperation between us and the community that makes it better.
Now, about the Justice Department role, Mayor Mitch Landrieu calls it a partnership and says, you know, he supports federal involvement in the department. What can we expect to happen with that in the coming weeks and the coming months?
I'm very excited about it. I think it's a perfect time to do this relationship. What the Department of Justice can bring us is an opportunity to look at some practices that the department's currently doing and say, you know, those are what the rest of the nation's doing, or this one you could be doing a little better. And quite honestly, folks, this one you need to just flat out change. I had the opportunity to do some consulting work through the Department of Justice when the Detroit Police Department was under consent order. And I saw it from the other side. It's a very positive environment. It's a very positive event, because what you're doing is you're bringing in experts who will help the administration figure out what needs to be corrected, what's already being good. And here's the most important thing. They bring in some money, too. I mean, we're going to be able to try to access some funding for some very important things. You know, probably what we need to do is get funding to completely outfit our in-car video system with lapel mics. That's very important to help us get the stage set on how we performed. We have not redistricted this police department. In other words, we have not redivided the pie, if you will, of this police department probably in 30 or more years. Are those boundaries for the district still valuable? Are they still valid? So one of the things I want to do is try to get some funding for some fairly sophisticated software programs that can tell us, this is how many pieces of pizza you need. This is how many pieces of pepperoni you need on the pizza. And when you start making that equalized workload across all the officers working 24 hours a day, you start to free up time so you can do some community policing, so you can do some foot beats, so you can do some community meetings. Right now, the district boundaries have not changed substantively in 30 or 40 years, and we made a slight tweak when I was here last time in the first district. Needs to be analyzed, needs to be reset.
Now, have you personally been in touch with Justice Department officials?
Absolutely. I've talked to Mr. Perez and his team several times. I think it's going to be great. I mean, in fact, I can't wait for them to get on the ground. Let me put it to the public this way, and this is what Mr. Perez says. I didn't say it. It's a great quote. I wish I'd have thought of it. He said, we're giving the police department and the city the benefit of the best consulting team you could have hired for free. I mean, think about that. Instead of hiring MGT America, or instead of hiring Matrix, or instead of hiring Kroll, which you would have paid hundreds of thousands of dollars for, the Department of Justice is going to bring that same level of expertise, research, science, and understanding of modern policing and give us that same result as if we'd had to pay some consultant for it. I'm so excited about it, I can't wait.
You're twitching. You're so exciting. Well, what about the federal investigations looking at the alleged misconduct in the department right now? You know, have you spoken with the FBI or U.S. Attorney Jim Letton?
I've had several conversations with Mr. Letton already. We rekindled our professional relationship from before. I've had several conversations with Mr. Welker at the FBI. I am absolutely confident that they're going to get to the bottom of each and every one of these cases, and I'm going to do everything I can to make sure that we help them get to the bottom of each and every one of these cases. When it's all said and done, it boils down to this. I've been a policeman 30 years. Somebody's been in my family in policing since 1914. When a police officer lies to the public, that's reprehensible. And then a little bit more is that when they lied to each other and said, oh, please trust me and believe me, I didn't do nothing wrong. And now you find out, not only did they lie to the public and take a life, it looks like, they lied to the officers that they wanted to rally behind them. It's just a bad thing all the way around. They need to go. They need to go.
Superintendent Ronald Serpas, thank you so much in studio with us this morning. Our conversation continues in the 9 o'clock hour. We're going to hear from the new chief again and his personal experiences at the department he called home for 31 years.